tonight, our speaker is Linda Rudolph, who we debated about whether she even needed any introduction. We don't think she does. I think she's well known to almost all of us in the bird club. She's an avid birder, travels all over the world, has given us wonderful presentations in the past, and we are looking forward to another one.
Go ahead, Linda.
Take it away, Linda.
Okay, so namaste, everybody. The title of the talk is Birds, Tigers, and the Taj Mahal, Visiting Magical Northeast India. I went on a 3-week birding tour to Northeast India, and it was led by a company called Field Guides Birding Tours. And it was in January of 2020. So this was right before the pandemic hit. So I was pretty lucky to get the trip in before all the COVID nonsense started. To me, India's always seemed like a mystical place. New Delhi's the capital, and you can see that I put a red star there where Delhi is. India has 23 official languages, and it's 1.35 billion people are compressed into a country one-third the size of the United States. There are 1,350 bird species documented in eBird in India, which is kind of similar to what's in the United States. India's about 12 hours ahead of us, and it takes about a day to fly to Delhi from Cedar Rapids. Traveling can be an adventure, and I ran into a problem right away. I was waiting at the gate in the Cedar Rapids airport at 5:30 a.m. when they announced that my flight had been canceled. Oh, what a disaster. So anyway, I was rebooked for later flights, and my 24-hour travel day turned into a 35-hour marathon. And I took this selfie once I was safe in my Delhi hotel room, and I felt really happy to have arrived in one piece. I arrived in Delhi 2 days before the birding trip began. And the first day, I met up with the local guide, and we went to Humayun's tomb. Humayun was a Mughal emperor, and the tomb was built starting in 1558. And it's the first known building to use white marble and red sandstone to such great effect. And it was really fun just to walk around among all the Indians and other tourists and get to see this wonderful building. But then, of course, we had to fit in some birding, too, even though I was going to be birding for 3 weeks. So we went to the Okla Bird Sanctuary. And this is kind of like a river area, marshy area, right in the city of Delhi. And I first got to see my first new book, Birds. And these are Indian spot-billed ducks. They're quite attractive. And you can see that they have this black bill with a yellow tip. Delhi is infamous for many things, and one of them is its winter smog. There's an inversion that occurs in Delhi commonly in the winter, and the smog is thick and noxious and as awful as anything you can imagine. And so this picture just shows you how thick the smog is. These are black-necked storks, and the picture's not clear just because of the smog. And you don't see it in all my photos from the Okla Bird Sanctuary just because of the sun direction, but you certainly sense it when you're trying to breathe in the air. This is a house crow. I think they're quite attractive. They have a little bit of a lighter gray around their neck. And this is maybe not the cutest bird in the world, but I love the blue colors on these gray-headed swamp hens. There's quite a range there. So I like them. I was there in January, so that's winter in India. and there weren't very many flowers blooming, so there aren't very many sunbirds around. Sunbirds are kind of like hummingbirds in that they have this long, decurved bill that they put in the flowers, and they drink the nectar. And like hummingbirds, they'll eat spiders and other little teeny insects. And I didn't get to see too many sunbirds, but this purple sunbird was hanging out where these pink flowers were. And then I saw my first palm swirl, and we got to see palm swirls almost every day. And they reminded me a lot of chipmunks. They're kind of cute, just about the same size. And this small Indian mongoose ran across the hiking path and then just stopped for just a minute and let me take his photo. Well, by the next day, most of the other participants had arrived, and we set off with the local guide again. And we went to the Jama Masjid Mosque, which was built starting in 1650. And of course, I knew you took off your shoes before you went into a mosque. But as we were entering the mosque, all the women were handed these loose outer garments. And of course, the mosque is just filled with tourists. You know, everybody's walking around. And it didn't take us long to realize that only foreign women had to wear these loose outer garments. So we just thought that was pretty funny. And we took a photo because the Indian women were in everything, you know, from pants to shirts to the, you know, traditional Indian dress. So we just thought that was kind of funny. And then after the mosque, we took a bicycle rickshaw ride through the market. Now, you can see on the right-hand side of the photo that there's two bicycle rickshaws ahead of me, and there was just this sea of people. It just gives you more of a feeling for how crowded parts of India are. And the other thing that's funny about this picture is if you look, you'll see that like the spaghetti works for wiring that exists in India. There's no such thing as really good electrical supply. And so you can see where some of the problem occurs. So the next day, the official bird tour started, and we took the train from Delhi to, and I'm going to butcher this name, Sawi Mudhopper, which is home to Ranthambore National Park. And we traveled 394 miles to the southwest. Well, even going by train in India is an adventure. The main Delhi train station handles 500,000 people a day, which is just an unfathomable number to me. There are 16 platforms and 480 trains. It's just a mass of confusing pathways and humanity. So when we drove up to the train station, there were porters that took our suitcases, and you can see that they put them on top of their heads, and they led the way to our platform. I don't know how you'd find it otherwise. And we followed those porters just like little ducklings follow a mama duck. And we went up and down rickety stairs on narrow bridges, over tracks, and through platforms. It was really crazy, quite an experience. So when we arrived at our hotel outside of Ranthambore National Park, we saw a group of German photographers exiting their canter. And that's the name of this open vehicle. And this is what groups use to ride around in Ranthambore National Park. And you go to Ranthambore in the hopes that you'll see a Bengal tiger in the wild. So it's quite exciting. And of course, we chatted with the German photographers, and they told us that they'd been there a week going. The access to the park's quite restricted. You can go for 2 hours in the morning and 2 hours in the afternoon. And they've been doing that for a week and had not seen a tiger. So of course our hopes were pretty dashed. But the next morning we got up and we set off in our own little canter. and we started to see sambar deer. Well, these are pretty big deer with considerable antlers. And our guide told us that sambar are the preferred tiger prey. And here's a little sambar eating a leaf. And our guide told us that every time he saw one of these sambar, he said, yum, tiger food. And here's the sambar that we saw wallowing in the mud. And he actually, you know, completely turned over with his little hooves up in the air. So it was kind of fun. And it was still quite early in the morning. And we started to hear a mated tiger pair up on a berm off to our left. And we could hear them yowling to each other and occasionally see an ear or tail, you know. And then all of a sudden the male just came walking down the berm and just walked right behind our canter. I couldn't believe it. It was just unbelievable. Just so exciting to get to see this magnificent animal out in the wild. Well, we hadn't gone too far from the mated pair when we saw a different female tiger slinking along through the brush. And our driver thought he knew where she was going to, and he drove ahead. And sure enough, she came out of the brush and lay down by some water. And then she sat up and kind of like she was surveying her kingdom. It was so cool. And then she started to walk towards us, and she got closer and closer. And in the end, she walked right by our canter. It was just unbelievable. We got to watch her for about 20 minutes, and it was a once-in-a-lifetime experience. Well, after the tiger excitement, then we start concentrating on birds and other things that we could see in Ranthambore National Park. So we saw Indian peafowl or peacocks out in the wild, and that was really fun to see them in their natural environment. Here's a peacock drinking water. And so going to the bathroom in Ranthambore National Park is a little bit of an experience because you drive into a completely fenced off compound. So tigers are kind of like polar bears in a way. They actually will hunt people. So they're very careful to fence off the bathrooms. Well, these Rufus tree pie have learned that all these open vehicles pull into the bathrooms, and people sometimes have, you know, their mid-morning snack with them or something, and they've become quite tame. They'll come down to the vehicle and beg for food. It was fun. This is a long-tailed shrike that was sitting up on a wire. And there's some water in Ranthambore National Park. Well, you saw the peacock drinking water, and we got to see quite a few red wattled lapwings. They're fairly common. And this is the beautiful laughing dove. So there was a place in the park where there's a little access road that goes up a hill that we did not go up. And there's a Hindu temple at the top, and people leave little offerings to the gods down at the bottom of this track. And these painted spurfowl are actually quite shy, and it's uncommon to see them. Maybe because there's little grain that's left there every day, they've learned to come out and eat the grain. So we got to see painted spurfowl out in the open. This is a great thick knee, and they're crepuscular and nocturnal. So, you know, they're active at dawn and dusk and in the middle of the night. And I've seen other thick knees during the day, but they've always been huddled under a bush. You don't see them standing, moving around. And it was really fun to get to see this guy out in the open. We asked the guide what they ate. And he laughed and said that with that big bill, They eat anything they can get their bill on. So that means crabs, large insects, and even small animals. And this rose ring parrot, he just flew down into the middle of the road so I could take a pretty picture. We got to see our first spotted owlets, and we saw them several days. And they're really cute. They tend to sit side by side like this, which was cute. We saw spotted or axis deer, and look at those long antlers on this guy. It's just kind of amazing. They can walk around with that big rack. But not only do they walk around, they spar together with those sharp antlers. I don't know how they don't hurt themselves. And we saw several troops of common langurs. So not large troops, maybe 10 or 20. They just kind of sit around in trees, just like this guy's doing. And here's a picture of them to show how long their tails are. So their tails are longer than their bodies. They're not very a huge monkey. They're about, the males are about 40 pounds. So not big, but fun to see. I like them. Here's a close-up common langur, and you just kind of wonder what they're thinking when you take their picture like that, and he's looking right at you. We also saw marsh muggers. These are really fierce-looking crocodiles. Males can be 15 feet long and weigh 400 pounds, and I would not want to get close to one of these guys. Here you can see his teeth up close and personal. Marsh muggers can be quite clever. And when birds are nesting, what they'll sometimes do is they'll lurk in the water and they'll put some reeds or twigs across their snout, trying to entice birds down to thinking that there's nesting material right there. And then of course, if the bird comes down and tries to get the nesting material, they'll grab them and eat them. And we did actually see a marsh mugger that had just caught a common langur, and he's busy dragging him down into the water. There were wild boar in the park. And we saw several small roosts of Indian flying fox. So during the day, flying foxes hang upside down in trees in little groups. These were quite small roosts, maybe 20 or 30 flying foxes. Flying foxes are fruit-eating megabats. And the Indian species is among the largest in the world. And if they unfurl their wingspan's about 4 feet. So they're pretty big. We were really lucky to see this Bengal fox. Our guide said he sees them maybe once every 5 years, that they're really reclusive and shy. And we hadn't even moved the vehicle, and we got to see this gorgeous painted sand grouse, just one of the prettiest, most subtly colored birds. Really fun to see. Our hotel there in Ranthambore had really nice grounds, and I loved to walk around and try to get my photos. This is a white wagtail, and all in all, we saw 6 different species of wagtails on this trip. This is an Indian robin, and look at that unusual color pattern. I can't think of any other bird that has black underbelly and black tail with a red crystal patch, and then the light brown top. It's really quite unusual. And of course, we have European starlings. There's other starlings in the world. This is a Brahmini starling. And here's an Asian pied starling running across the lawn. I don't know what he was after. But the most unusual bird I got to see on the hotel lawn was this Eurasian wryneck. So first of all, I was just fascinated by the pattern of the feathers. You can see that there's barring and scalloping and arrows. It was really beautifully colored. Wryniks are woodpeckers, and they quite commonly come down to the ground where they probe for ants and beetles and moths and spiders. It's not unusual to see them like this, but they're called a wryneck because they can turn their head 180 degrees. So of course I wanted to see this behavior, and I watched them for about 20 minutes and I never did get to see them do that. And then this is diminutive bayback shrike, and I think that's the most adorable shrike I've ever seen. He's really just cute. So as the sun set on January 14th, 2020, I thought I'd never had a better day in the field, and that I would always think of this as my day of the tiger. Well, the next day, of course, we had to go birding. So we took off in what's called a gypsy jeep. And I'd never ridden in a vehicle like this. So there's a door for the driver, but of course you're sitting behind the driver and there's no door. You clamber in over the side of this vehicle. There's no seatbelt. There's no real grab bar in front of you. I thought, oh my gosh, we are going to be driving in this vehicle. It did not seem safe. And of course, this was my first experience driving through villages in India. And I didn't realize how slow the traffic moved. It never goes fast. So there's really no danger at all from being completely insecure in this open vehicle. This is a typical scene as you're driving along. So you can see why the traffic doesn't move fast. You're all pressed together on this narrow road and you're competing with space with everything you can imagine, including cows that are walking around loose. So cows in India are considered sacred, and they really do just walk around wherever they want to. You can see this cow's just walking in front of this vehicle, and they'll just sit there and wait for him to move. Many of the cows actually even have bling on them. So if you look carefully, you can see that this cow has a silver bell and colored string and beads. And when you think about how poor some of the villages are, it's really something to see how they've decorated their cows. And this baby cow is tied to a tree, but you can see that he has a blanket on him to help keep him warm and protect him from the cold. It's just like we would blanket a pet horse. Well, we went to a reservoir in our gypsy jeeps, and the rarest bird we saw at the reservoir was the Indian skimmer. And if you've never seen a skimmer fly, you have to imagine, you can see this lower mandible, how much longer it is than the upper mandible. And what skimmers do is they have long wings and they fly very close to the surface of the water, and they put their lower mandible in the water, and when it hits a fish, it closes and it snaps shut, and that's how they eat. So they're really fun to watch. And we saw a flock of 76 birds, and they put on quite a show for us. They were flying back and forth, and this photo gives you an idea of their wingspan. They have very long wings. However, it started to rain, and we had our first soaking experience in the gypsy jeeps, because of course there's no top in those open vehicles, and we did get quite wet. The next day, we took the upcountry train to Bharatpur, 140 miles to the north. Our weather was very bad there. It was cold and rainy and foggy, and this yellow-footed green pigeon is all fluffed up against the cold mist, and we all wished we had his insulating feathers. That was how we felt. It was just pretty miserable. And this is what the yellow-footed green pigeon looks like when he's not all huddled up against the cold. We did get to see our first white-throated kingfisher. And boy, these are pretty birds. And look at that big red bill. It's really quite something. And they're actually fairly common. We got to see them fairly frequently. And we watched a Eurasian hoopoe probing in the ground looking for ants. So that was a lot of fun. But really, truly, we did not get to see Barrett Poor. It's a lovely place. They have these paths that you have your own bicycle rickshaw. And so you have somebody who pedals you along and you can stop wherever you want. And there's water and trees and birds. We can hear birds everywhere. But because of the thick fog, we really didn't get to see very clearly very many birds. So I can't really say that I've gotten to experience Barrett Poor yet. So the next day we took a bus west to Agra. And the next morning we were off to see one of the most famous buildings in the world. And this is what we saw. Our terrible weather followed us. Oh my gosh, it was just really something to stand there and just have this fog. So we took a tour in the inside. The Taj Mahal is a marble mausoleum built starting in 1632 by the Mughal Emperor Shah Jahan for his favorite wife who died, Mumtaz Mahal. And you go in, and there's a tomb, and it's, you can't take any photos, and it's really pretty. There's inlaid marble with semi-precious gems. It's really quite a sight. And of course, the weather being so awful, there were not a lot of people around. We just got to enjoy it and spend as much time as we wanted to. Well, while we were inside, the weather cleared, and we actually got to see it. It was so much fun. And then we were really like tourists. We all stood around and had our pictures taken with the building in the background. It was just really charming. And we even took a group photo. So this is our group, our birding group. And it was just a fun time. The next day we headed to the Chambal River for a boat ride. It was a longish and sometimes muddy walk from where we were dropped off down to the riverbank. And I just had to take a picture of this tuk-tuk. We never got to ride in a tuk-tuk, but I like the looks of this decorated one. And this is typical of some things in India where they just excessively decorate something. And I just thought it was quite charming. On the boat ride, we got to see painted storks, which are kind of unusually colored because they have this soft pink feathers on their rump, but kind of an orangish yellow bill. We saw gray herons, which look a lot like our great egrets, our great blue herons, and black wing stilts, which, like our black-necked stilts, have bubblegum pink legs. White-breasted water hens. And another wagtail, the gray wagtail. And white-browed wagtails. But the main reason for going to the Chambal River was to see gharial. Well, I'd never even heard of gharial before. These are fish-eating crocodile, and they're really shy. They never let us get too close to them. So not like the marsh muggers that are just really dangerous looking. These guys are shy. They're huge. They can be up to 20 feet long, and they have these really long snouts with very fine teeth. And one thing about gharial, which is odd, is the males have these pots at the end of the beak. So you can see the snout that's sticking out the furthest on the right has this growth on the end. And that means that's a male. Here's a gharial that's getting ready to go into the water. And it kind of gives you an idea of how big they really are. Well, the bird I most wanted to see in India were these bar-headed geese. And I don't know if you've ever heard about bar-headed geese, but what I had heard about them is that they've been seen flying over Mount Everest, and that sometimes airliners, you know, which are cruising at 35,000 feet, will see bar-headed geese. They're really quite attractive. And I read a little bit about them. Recently, they've been tagged a few flocks with GPS devices. And so they can actually record how high they're flying. And the highest these tagged geese have flown is 23,000 feet. So not as high as Mount Everest, which is 29,000 feet, but still pretty high, higher than I could fly. And here's a lovely ruddy shell duck. Well, after our boat ride, we ate lunch up at a, I'm not sure what you'd call it, like I guess a lodge. And we walked the grounds of the lodge and we saw this brown bubak on his day roost. And in all, we saw 8 species of owls on this trip without going night owling once. So that's the kind of owling I like when you don't have to stay up late. Here's an Indian Scots owl just hanging out. And the next day was a travel day and we drove to Ramangar by bus. This is outside Corbett National Park, and Corbett may be the most famous park in India. And it's like Ranthambore in that it's a what they call a tiger park. So tiger parks are just areas where there's no villagers because tigers can eat people. So it's not that the tigers are confined in any manner. It's just that there's no villagers there that the tigers are busy attacking. But we stayed inside Corbett for a few days, but we mostly stayed outside the park. And that's just so that we could hike around without worrying about being attacked by tigers. Certainly not a problem we have in Iowa. This was the only place where I got to see a few butterflies. And this is a dark, glassy tiger butterfly. And we started to see rhesus macaques now. He looks so gentle, doesn't he? And sweet. But we found out they're anything but. Macaques travel in pretty big troops on the ground. And we were warned, like every 5 minutes, not to have any food on us. It soon became apparent that the rhesus macaques are a real menace. And every window and door was secured against them. Our gypsy Jeep drivers even carried large sticks to fend them off. They have very large teeth and can be aggressive if they think you have food. So they're cute, but stay far away. And there were a few flowers blooming around here. So the flowers were attracting the butterflies. And also we got to see these pretty green-tailed sunbirds. And here, this bird's really nicely showing his decurved beak. We saw our first Himalayan bulbuls. And they have this cute little top knot. And then one day when we were driving, we saw this bull Indian elephant. And I'm not sure if you can see, but right in front of his ear, you can see there's that wet kind of area. This means that this bull is in musk. And when they're in musk, their testosterone is 40 times higher than normal. And it creates immense pressure inside their head. They're not sure why this happens. And it can last months. And these bulls, when they have are in this condition, are considered very dangerous. And so we stopped, and I just grabbed this photo, and we were on our way. I mean, we did not linger so close to this very dangerous elephant. We went to the Ramnagar Barrage, and I'm really sorry I didn't get a photo of the overall thing. The barrage is a dam. It's a working hydroelectric dam. And there's a pretty, like a Cedar River size river that runs through the dam. And there's not much of a water impoundment upriver. So just a little teeny impoundment. And this barrage is wide enough that you can actually drive over it. But most of the time it's closed and it just has pedestrian traffic. And on one side of the barrage is a very busy market. So there's people all over. And on the other side of the barrage is a busy Hindu temple. So people are going to the temple. It's a spectacle. There are birds everywhere. They're flying over the dam, flying over you, landing in the river. And there's people going back and forth. It was just really fun. And this is a common myna that was sitting right on the rail. And here's a cute little pied kingfisher just waiting for his next nap. But the reason you go to the Ramnagar Barrage is because there's usually a wintering wall creeper there. And so, so you have to look, and it probably took us maybe 20 minutes for our entire group, and we were spread out checking every piece of concrete before we finally got to see this cute little bird. And wall creepers are related to nuthatches. You can see he's a soft gray with this beautiful crimson wing, and we actually got to see him do his behavior. So what they do is they open their wings, and you can see he has these bright white spots, and they flutter their wings, and they scare in, and it stops it. It scares the insects, and then they go grab the insect, and that's how they forage. And the normal experience, what I'm told of seeing a wall creeper, is you stand at the foot of the Pyrenees, and you look up about 3,000 feet through a telescope, and you get to see this little teeny bird way up there. So we were very fortunate to get to see him up close like that. So we did go into Corbett National Park quite a bit. We drove around in our gypsy jeeps. It was really fun. I don't know, it's a lovely place. It's great. This kind of gives you a better idea of the topography. We got to see two more tigers and several elephant herds, but they were all at quite a distance. So it wasn't nearly the experience that we had in Ranthambore with our tiger. And one day I got to see this osprey perching right in front of me. And I always like to see what we consider our birds when you're someplace like half the way around the world. It's kind of fun. This is a Siberian stonechat. And one morning we were out pretty early. And we were parked underneath some trees. And all of a sudden we sensed that we were there was this vibration in our bones. And it took us a little bit to realize that it was actually a deep sound that was vibrating. And we looked up, and there were a pair of these brown fish owls. This one was perched right above us. And there was one in the tree, maybe, 50 feet away. And they were hooting back and forth. And that's what was making this such a sound that was so deep. It really felt like it was vibrating in your body. And you can see his throat pouch is all swollen as he's hooting back and forth. This is a little jungle outlet, kind of mean looking. So we're getting towards the end of our trip, and we headed off to the Himalayan foothills. And it took most of the day to work our way up to Nainital, which is just to the right of the northmost red star. And of course, I was really excited about this part of the trip, to think that I was going to be in the Himalayas, you know, just seemed so cool. And I've read, several novels about India. And actually, this is quite pertinent to this time, because Nainital is one of those places that people decamp to in the summer because of the Delhi heat. And I don't know if you guys have heard, but Delhi's been in the news lately because they are having repeated heat waves, and it's been 116 degrees there. So it's just almost unimaginable when you have that unreliable electrical grid, very little air conditioning, and the mass of people, what it would be like to live there. It's just unimaginable, really. So Nainital is a lovely village up in the Himalayan foothills, maybe at 7,000 or 8,000 feet of elevation. So it's quite cool. And our bad weather followed us. So we got up then the morning after arrival, and we got in 4x4 Jeeps or SUVs. And it was foggy and misty and cold, very cold. And, but we went up higher, and we went to a place called Snow View, where you kind of climb up and you look out and you can see the high Himalayas. I mean, it was awesome. And we had gone up high enough that we are above the cloud level. So if you look over the first little bump there and you see that white stuff, that's the clouds that we climbed up above. And of course it was beautiful and clear. And we got to see the tallest mountain that's entirely within India, and that's Nanda Devi. And it's the mountain that's on the right here. It's 25,600 feet tall. And it's about 75 miles away from our viewpoint. So that was just worth being in Nainital if that was all we got to see. But of course, we saw some birds too. This is the pretty oriental turtle dove and a cute little white-tailed nuthatch. And we just walked around through villages, up and down pretty steep hills, and saw birds. It was really fun, despite the pretty cold and foggy and misty weather. But this picture just kind of gives you an idea of the topography. It was lovely. I enjoyed it. One day when we were walking, we saw this Himalayan palm civet. And this was really unique because not a single person in the group had seen one of these animals before, which is quite unusual. None of the drivers, none of the guides, none of the participants had seen one before. So that was really fun. And here's just a picture of some Indian women, and I like their bright colors that they seem to favor in this part of India. This might be my favorite bird of the trip. This is a rufous-bellied Niltava. And Niltava are flycatchers, and this bird was very shy. It wanted to stay right in the middle of a bush in the hidden in the leaves, and I love the electric blue of the feathers. Another day we were walking, and we walked right by this sign, and right by it, and I'm like, whoa, wait a second, this looks pretty important. So I asked the guide, and this Starting with the skull and crossbones that we think of as like poison, is warning people not to swim. There was a pond behind here, and not too big, and I guess it's unexpectedly deep, and they've had quite a few people drown. So I think this sign would scare anybody from swimming there. This is a long-tailed minivet. And here's a pretty maroon oriole. And we got to watch the oriole beat this caterpillar against the branch for quite a bit, trying to get all those spiky hairs off the caterpillar before it ate it. Here's a black hooded oriole with a bright red eye. And then we're coming to the end of the trip, and we go back to Delhi, and our last day is going to be at Sultanpur Jahil National Park. And like Bharatpur, I can't really say that I've seen Sultanpur because our fog and cold and mist followed us. We even tried walking a field for pipits and larks. I didn't get to add any to my life list because you would see this like shape moving in the fog. You really couldn't see anything. But this large gray babbler perched right next to me. So I got to take his photo. And Sultanpur is like Bharatpur. There's water and you don't have bicycle rickshaws. You just walk on the paths. But we really didn't get to fully appreciate the pretty park. We did get to see Nilgai. Nilgai are the largest antelope in Asia, and this is a group of female. They're pretty big, but the thing about Nilgai is the male Nilgai look nothing like the females. So the male Nilgai are called the blue bull, and you can see why. It doesn't even look like it's the same animal. So that was really fun to get to see one. And then as we were leaving Bharatpur, I saw this sign and it says, nature provides a tree lunch, but only if we control our appetite, save wildlife, by William, and the name's wrong. So I kind of recognize that name. And I had not seen the quote before, but it's just so endearing. And I looked it up when I got home. And William Ruckelshaus was actually our first EPA administrator. And the quote is, nature provides a free lunch, but only if we control our appetites. So I thought that was a perfect ending to a very interesting trip. Despite our terrible weather, I saw 325 species or 28 species in India. I thought people were universally friendly and helpful. And I really felt lucky to have visited and to have seen so much. And I'd really be happy to try to answer any questions you have. Obviously, I'm not an India expert, but I'd be happy to try to entertain any questions if you have some.
All right. So does anybody have any questions? I just have to say, Linda, I mean, I wish we didn't have to be muted during the talk, because it's like our reaction. I mean, my reaction was like, oh my God. Oh my God. Oh, that's so cute. I mean, it just, oh, Linda, the photographs are magnificent. The storytelling, the tigers. Oh my God. I mean, I'm just, like I said, I wish we weren't muted, because you would have known how much all of us, I'm sure, were just absolutely enjoying that. That was just amazing.
Oh, thank you, Terry.
It was great photography. Really great.
Thank you. Of course, I only showed you the pictures that I like.
Well, I do remember you saying something about going through like 8,000 photos or something.
I do, yeah. 8,000, but yeah.
Was this your first trip to India?
It was, Karen. And Field Guides offers another trip to southern India. And I very much want to go. I really enjoyed the trip. It was just wonderful from every aspect, except for I'm not fond of Indian food, but you can always eat the bread and the rice. I made it through, but otherwise it was really fun. It's quite an adventure. It's probably a more adventuresome country to go to than some others. You know, your electricity doesn't work, your running water doesn't work, you know, things like that. It's just not, the travel's quite difficult in the country. But, you know, if you're willing to have some inconveniences like that, it's really, really interesting and fun.
Well, it was a marvelous talk. Beautiful pictures.
Thank you.
And I was listening to you and I actually go, oh, I wish I could see this all over again. And I thought, wait a minute, it's being recorded. I can see it all over again. I just was amazed. It was just wonderful.
How many species did you say you saw when you were there?
328.
Wow.
Which is just incredible when you think about our weather, the weather that we had. The weather truly was awful. And it's just like here, you know, the weather's odd and not normal. They normally don't have that terrible, rainy, misty, cold fog.
And then Linda, of all those species, how many were new for you? How many were life birds?
Oh, boy, I don't remember, Terry. That's a good question. Most of them, you know, there's some birds that you see repeatedly, like I'd seen the oriental turtle dove before, osprey and black kites. And so there's some species that I've seen, but probably 250, I would guess. I usually study the birds ahead so that when you're out in the field and they're saying like rufous belly miltava, you know, you're not like, I've never even heard those words before. Where am I going to put that in my brain? In addition to trying to find the bird in the bush. And of course, I'm trying to take photos. So it does help to have studied, you know, ahead and feel like you have a little bit of a grasp of some of the birds.
Phenomenal photos, just phenomenal.
Well, thank you.
I just can't get over it. I can't wait to watch it again. Really.
Did you share photos at night or have group discussions and talk about what you saw? Or were you pretty much all saw the same thing?
So everybody pretty much sees the same thing. The field guide just really prides itself on having a small group and having very knowledgeable guides that work hard to get every participant on the birds. And every night at dinner, you go through the checklist. So they have a prepared, bound list of the birds that you can potentially see on the trip. And it's gridded. So every day, you know, you can go through and check the birds that you saw that day. And you don't go through the photos because photo editing is, so photos are taken. Like, well, at least I take photos in a manner that's not easily shareable. You have to edit them first. And I don't bring all the stuff that you need to edit photos with me on a trip. I just wait until I get home to do that.
Then you get to do the trip all over again, practically, huh?
I do. And photo editing, it's just a labor of love, but it's a real labor. It takes, you know, hours and hours of sitting there going through and picking your photos and just doing different things with them.
What kind of things do you have to do, Linda? What do you do to them?
So they're taken in a format called RAW, and you have to bring that up on the computer, and you can adjust levels, say it's underexposed or overexposed. You can change that in the RAW format, and then you change it to the JPEG format, which is the format that you're used to sharing and things like that. And then I label them and I load them into eBird and I make a photo gallery and just different things like that.
Wow.
What kind of camera did you take?
So that camera I no longer have. I managed to fall in a pond this summer, and cameras and water do not get along. So that camera was a Canon 7D Mark II, and it was 100 to 400 zoom lens. There's the second iteration. So they no longer make that setup. So I'm learning a new camera, and that's been fairly painful. I have a Canon, and you'd think my knowledge from the old camera would transfer to the new camera, but oh no, I've had a whole new learning process. So I'm working at it still. And I got a mirrorless camera for my new camera. It's a Canon R5, and they have 100 to 500 millimeter lens that goes with that.
Do you carry binoculars too, or you use the camera instead?
I always think of myself as a birder first. So I carry the binoculars and I look at the birds first. So I miss a lot of photos because I'm busy looking at the birds. But you're right, Terry, when you look through your camera lenses, you can see almost as much as you see with the binoculars.
Wow.